Before we go into these questions, we ought to talk over together. If we can ask a question from a state of mind or brain that is holistic, that sees, comprehends, or perception of the whole human problem, not just one particular problem, but all problems are related to each other. There is no one separate problem disassociated from the others. If that is so, then to ask a question or to face a problem from an integrated outlook. You understand? Most of us are fragmented, broken up. Business, religious, family life, sexual life, religious life, and so on and so on. We're all not a holistic, whole human beings, which is a fact. We look at life from a particular point of view, from a conclusion, or from some idealistic concepts. These are all fragmented outlook on life, right? We are talking things over together. And can we ask or face a problem from a wholly different outlook, which is not fragmented at all? You understand? Are we meeting each other in this? We just thought of it as we came across the lawn here. Whether we ask any question or face any problem holistically, I hope you don't mind using that word, though one has a so-called scientific word, but we can, I hope the scientists will forgive us if we use that word. From a point of total integration, integrity, and ask questions. It's rather interesting if we go into it. Is it possible, recognizing that we are fragmented, broken up, divided in ourselves, contradictory, opposing one desire against another desire, and so on, knowing all that, being aware of all that, could we face a problem which is from a different focus? Why do we have problems? We've got so many problems, political, religious, sexual, and so on. We have multiple problems. things in life. And problems are increasing in a society that is so sophisticated, so complex. Overpopulation, bad governments, and so on. And in the resolution of one problem, we seem to increase many other problems. Right? Why? In answering this question, that's going to raise the answer is going to awaken similar problems. Why do we have problems, and is it possible to meet a problem without a brain that is already conditioned to solve problems?
I don't understand.
Huh? You don't understand. Neither do I for the moment. So let's look at it. We go to school very young, almost 5 or 7 and so on, and we are, children are faced with a problem, mathematical problem, how to write, how to read, how to learn mathematics, you know, it becomes a problem. So from childhood, our brain is conditioned to solving problems, right? This is a fact. It's not some fantastic theory of the speaker. So one goes to college, there again problems. And university, jobs, various functions, vocations and so on, problem after problem. Our brain is full of problems, right? And we're always seeking from a brain that is conditioned to solve problems, we're always seeking a solution to problems, right? Is this clear? We are together in this. Now, how can the brain solve problems if it is not free from problems? Right? Are we together a bit in this? Rather interesting question, this. Please let's go into this. Our brains are conditioned to the resolution of problems. Solution of problems from childhood. And as the brain is conditioned to solve problems, it's always seeking a solution. And it's not understanding the problem itself, but the solution of the problem, right? Are we together a little bit in this? Yes? Good. And is it possible not to have a brain, to have a brain that is not conditioned to problems? You understand my question? I'm asking you, sirs and ladies, your brain is conditioned now to the solution of problems. And we have never solved the problems. They're increasing more and more and more. Why? Is it because a conditioned brain, which is embedded in problems, can ever solve problems. Right, you understand? Have I put the question? Oh, come on, sir. Is it possible to have a brain that is not conditioned to the solution of problems, but to the understanding of problems? Isn't there a difference between the solution of problems and the understanding of the problem? In the understanding of the problem, the solution may lie in the problem, not away from the problem, right? Take a very ordinary example. We have never stopped wars. Human beings on this earth, since they have come on this earth, have had wars. And we have never solved the problem of war. But we try to reorganize how to kill man better. And this reorganization, how to kill man better, is called progress. I don't know if you're following all this. This is not a joke. So we move from organization to organization. We had first the League of Nations, and now we have the United Nations, but wars go on. They have different organizations. You know? So we move from one organization to another, hoping thereby to solve problems and multiply problems. So we never stop war. And the cause of war is nationalism, economic division, local division, and so on, so on, so on. Division. Linguistic, racial, religious, economic, cultural, and so on. These divide man. We're all human beings. We all suffer. We all have pain and anxiety and boredom, loneliness, despair. We don't tackle that, but we want to solve the problems that seems to have an external causes, right? So we are asking, can the brain, recognizing, seeing that it is conditioned to the solution of problems from childhood, be free of it and then face problems? Right? All right, sir. Will you do it? That is the question. To be conscious, to be aware that our brain, that we, as human beings, from the beginning of life, we're always struggling with problems and trying to find the right answer to them. The right answer can only be when we recognize the brain is conditioned. And as long as that brain is conditioned to solving problems, we will never find the right answer. Clear? So, do I recognize that fact? Not the idea, but the fact. There's a difference between idea and the fact. Right? I hear this statement, and from that statement I draw a conclusion, quite right, is it so? And from that statement, I abstract an idea of it, and then pursue the idea. Not the fact that my brain is conditioned to solve problems. That's the fact. Not that I should be free of this conditioning. That's not fact. You understand? So, the brain is conditioned. And as long as the condition exists, multiplications of problems will go on, reorganization of the problems will go on, and changing from one capitalist society to totalitarian society or this or that will always be bring about enormous problems, right? Can you and I be free of the brain that is conditioned? That is to be aware of it and see the depth of it, the truth of it, the logic, the sanity, the reason of it, and not move away from that. Not find some abstract explanations. Right. Is this all right? I'm asking if it's all right, perhaps it's all wrong. No, it's not all wrong. This is a fact. If one cannot get on with one's wife, quarrels, contention, and all the rest of it, and one divorces, then go to choose another person and keep on repeating this, right? If one has the money, and if one has plenty of time and energy. This is the game that's going on in the world, on a small or a bigger scale. But the problem is not divorce or on all the complications of relationship, but to understand the depth of relationship, the meaning of relationship. Relationship, as we pointed out, is one of the most important things in life. Not the emotional expressions of it, the tantrums, the neuroticism of relationship, but what is important, significant, depth in relationship. And we never ask that question. We want to solve the problem of relationship, you understand? And so we never solve them. The psychiatrists, psychotherapists, and so on, are multiplying in the world, like mushrooms. And they're not solving problems. They're not solving the depth of all this. So we should consider together what is the art of living. You understand? Oh, come on, sir. It's a nice morning. That's right. Lady is saying, if we have a system, a pattern of solving a problem, then the system is operating not the understanding and the depth of the problem. Right? The same thing. We were talking about the art of living. Sorry, these are the questions, but there it is. You don't mind? We'll come to that. There are many of them, so we've chosen six of them. That'll be enough for this morning. But we're asking, what's the art of living? We have the art of poetry, painting, the art of so many, art of cooking, especially now, and so on. But we've never asked ourselves, perhaps which is the greatest art, what is the art of living? Is there an art? Or is it all the chance? Or is it all some genes? A biological chances and so on. What is the true art of living? Are you waiting for me to answer it? If one answers it, don't make a problem of it. Then the art is thrown out of the window. So let's look at it together to find out what is the art of living. Art in the widest and the depth of that word, not just all the contents of a museum. If you were asked that question, what is the art of living? What would be your answer? Not calculated answer, personal answer, or emotional romantic answer, which are meaningless. Right? If I answer that question emotionally, oh, it is the most, art of living is the highest aspiration. Which is sheer nonsense. Art of living is the most exalted intellectual activity. Right? That's only very partial. Or art of living is to have a holistic outlook on life. Sounds excellent. But factually it isn't. So what is the art of living? Obviously, no conflict whatsoever. Right? A brain that is in conflict all the time, having problems all the time, this tremendous self-concern. Such a brain must inevitably be limited, right? If one is thinking about oneself, how to meditate, whether you can, all the rest of it. Your very meditation is self-centeredness. So, the art of living, it appears, you can add to it more, to live without conflict. Is that possible at all? That is to understand the opposing elements in one's life, right? Desiring one thing, opposed to that desire another thing. You know, this corridor of dualities. And this self-centeredness. As long as that self-centeredness exists, there must be conflict. Because self-centeredness is limited, small, petty. But you listen to all this, but carry on. Right? And you say that's not possible in modern society to live without self-centeredness, at least a little bit of it. Have you ever tried? Have you ever done, lived without self-centeredness for one day? Not to think about oneself. Just even for an hour. And see what happens. You haven't committed to anything. You can go back to your self-centeredness. Nobody's going to say how wrong it is or right it is. That's the normal state of human beings, apparently. So, if one really tries for an hour, actually do it, not try it, do it and see what happens. And if you do it 1 hour, you can extend it. And you don't, it gives you tremendous energy. It gives you great sense of passion. Not lust and all the business, but the passion to pursue something profoundly to the very end of things. Right. Is that enough for this? You better come back.